If you would like to hold the invitation hymn today, that'll be page 145. And it's time to come around the Lord's table this morning. And our communion hymn will be page 119.
Come to the reason that we gather on the first day of the week. And you know, they mentioned Veterans Day, and there's a bigger holiday on Friday, and that's Marine Corps birthday for all of y'all that aren't Marines. But I promise this is going somewhere. But Brett had brought up a good point last communion meditation last week, and he said that this is about Jesus, not us. And we had plenty of time leading up to this service to get ourselves ready, and our meditation is focused on our worship where it belongs. Friday is the Marine Corps birthday, and it's celebrated with a huge dinner, one of the few times that we actually enjoy to eat the chow hall food. And this got me thinking about the motto, Semper Fidelis, always faithful. Anytime one of us Marines pass another, we can say Semper Fi, and we automatically know it's a brother or sister. We can look at each other and help would be given with no questions and not even knowing who the other person is. And all of this loyalty amounts to nothing. Not every Marine will help another one out. Not every Marine continues to uphold the core values. And the Marine Corps itself gives us nothing back. And this motto contains the word absolute. Yet it's never absolute and never will be. But we're here today for the one true absolute. The one who planned to hang on that cross thousands of years ago, and he did. The one who said he'd rebuild this temple in 3 days, and he did. The one he'd said he'd send the comforter, and he did. The one who said he would not drink of the fruit of the vine until he drinks it anew in the kingdom with us, and he will. The one who said he would return for us, and he will. If there is ever a motto to emulate, it would be, Jesus Semper Fidelis. Jesus is always faithful. Let us now gather around the table and celebrate the Lord and Savior, the always faithful Jesus. I'll ask the men to pray.
Our Father in heaven, we do thank you again for this time that you have led us together back in your house this morning. We continue to thank you for each time that we can come here to read and study and learn more from your word. He's kept us to take it and apply it to our lives. We do thank you for the ones that's here with you this morning. Help us all continue to be faithful to you and serve you better. Thank you now for this time to come around the table and be with us as we partake for this bread. His body is broken up on that cross for us. For as often as we do partake, we do show the death we have. But most of all, we thank you for the one who died on the cross and shed his blood for us. We just pray now that you'll continue to be with us through the service this morning. Throughout this day, be with those that couldn't be with us if we weren't in our sickness. And we tell you, of course, you do. Thank you. Well, we just pray that you'll be with us, forgive us of our sins and mistakes. In Jesus' name we pray.
Father in heaven, we continue in prayer this morning. We're so thankful for the wonderful blessings you give us each day of our lives, Lord. Thank you for the freedom we have to be here and worship you. Thank you, Father, for all you do for us, Lord. I pray that all we do and say here today will be comforting to you, will uplift your name in some way. But, Father, I pray that you'll be with Brent as he brings our message. Bless our sick, for we heal him at your will. Be with us now as we come around your table. We thank you, Father, for this cup, which is your son's shed blood. We pray, Father, that you'll help us to live each day. In some way we can glorify your name and lift your name up in some way, Lord, each day of our life. Forgive us now when we fail you. My prayer in your son's name. Amen.
You know, when we think about great fathers and we think about, again, that term, that absolute, that always term, you know, God is the one that is a constant absolute. He will always take care of us. Mm-hmm. And many times, even if we think back to the times when we were children, the things that we thought we needed weren't the best for us. But then our parents, if we had good parents, made sure we had the things that we needed. It's not always best for us to eat an entire tub of ice cream. So we didn't get an entire tub of ice cream, right? And that Father we have in heaven knows the best things for us and provides us what we absolutely need. So when we reach out our pockets, don't let the father of doubt, the devil, cloud our minds. Reach in our pockets and give back what we know we need to give back, and know that the Father is going to take care of us. And I'll ask Teddy Vines if he'll pray for the offering.
Our Heavenly Father, we truly are thankful, Father, that you love us, Father, and that you gave, Father, your Son, God, to suffer and die, and to shed his blood for our sins. We thank you, Father, for the message, Father, that Fred will preach this morning. We pray, Father, that you be with him, bless him and his family, and forgive us, I pray. And thank you, Father, for the offering, for the offering, Father, that men made this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Please, let's stand and sing, I'm Blessed. I wonder how many of us sitting here today really believe that we've been blessed. If you really believe that, that means that's something you think on continually about how good God's been to you. It's called mercy. It's called grace. Now, when you hear those two words, mercy and grace, and you apply that to somebody else, because of how mean they are, how sorry they are, what a sorry family they come from, or this or that. When you apply grace and mercy to someone else, letting it pass right over you, you don't really understand what a bad condition spiritually you're in. Stop praying for grace and mercy for other people and start begging God for it for yourself. Because you need it every day. Quit focusing on, oh, look what she's wearing today. I wonder who's this or what's that. I can't, what an ugly bright tie that is. You know he can afford better than that. Lord God, I pray for grace and mercy for them. You better be praying for it for yourself, because your worship means nothing at all to God. You think I'm crazy? Go to Isaiah chapter 1. Isaiah chapter 1. Going to see a bunch of people done everything right the way God wanted it done, and their worship made him sick to his stomach. As a matter of fact, everything that they did, he didn't dislike, he hated. But oh, they were so righteous and better than anybody else around them. But he hated everything they did, even though it was right and the right way. She may be able to tell me what the name Isaiah means. You know what the name Isaiah means? If you know it, just say it out. Well, then you're going to learn something. Isaiah means the salvation of the Lord. That's what Isaiah means. He is the son of Amos, A-M-O-Z, not Amos the prophet, A-M-O-Z. He lived during the reign of five different kings in the southern kingdom of Judah. The book of Isaiah sometimes is called the Gospel of Isaiah because it's full of good news. It's full of coming salvation, salvation at hand, an opportunity to be right with the Lord. It's also called the Romans of the Old Testament. because God really hits on sin and how headsick the people are because of the life in which they live. Isaiah's message throughout calls sinners to recognize themselves as sinners and to repent. And then there is the promise in Isaiah of forgiveness to those who humble themselves. You'll never have forgiveness until you humble yourself for you to realize the mercy and grace you need from God. Forget everybody else. This is about you. And to be right with God, you have to be humble to be able to receive forgiveness of sins. You see, the Jews here in Isaiah's time, they had some awful big heads. They knew who, what family they come from, the education that was there, the way they knew the scrolls and could tell you where the what was in the scroll and in what section of the scroll. Oh, you have to know where I come from. How smart and dedicated and righteous that I am. That was their attitude. Like some Christians' attitude in the church today. They don't need mercy and grace. Everybody else does, though. And that is the attitude of each and every one of these Jews in Isaiah's day. In Isaiah, the first chapter, let's read verses 1 and 2. The vision of Isaiah, the son of Amoz, which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem in the day of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, Hezekiah, kings of Judah. Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord hath spoken. I have nourished and brought up children, and they have rebelled against me. The ox knoweth his owner, and the ass his master's crib, but Israel doth not know. My people doth not consider. The Lord said, even dumb animals know who feeds them. Even dumb animals know who owns them. But my people act like they don't have any idea who I am. Read verse 10 there with me. Hear the word of the Lord, ye rulers of Sodom. Give ear unto the law of God, ye people of Gomorrah. He's calling them Sodomites. Boy, that's strong, isn't it? And to call a Jew one of Sodom or of Gomorrah, that was like cussing them to their face. They knew the story. They had heard what happened to Sodom and Gomorrah because God detested them so much that he destroyed them. And here he says, you children of Sodom and Gomorrah, how sorry the people must have been, but yet still claiming their righteousness. Obviously to me, God, through Isaiah, was not trying to smooth over anything, was he? He wasn't trying to keep from hurting anybody's feelings. He wasn't watching his words so that nobody would get mad. That ain't what the Lord was doing here, was it? He's putting them in their face what they was. They were people that didn't need his grace and mercy. They were not thankful. They did not worship him as he wanted to be worshiped. Everybody else needed grace and mercy. Everybody else needed to work on their worship service. Everybody else needed to work on their clothes and their hair and this and that and the other. But they've got everything perfect, you see. And God detested them. Called them Sodomites. Think of that. That's pretty strong, isn't it? Let's look at verses 11 through 17 with me. To what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices unto me? Saith the Lord, I am full of the burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fed beasts. I delight not in the blood of bullocks or of lambs or of goats. When you come to appear before me, who hath required this at your hand to tread my courts? Bring no more vain oblations. Incense is an abomination unto me. The new moons and the Sabbaths, the calling of assemblies, I cannot away with it. It is iniquity, even the solemn meeting. Your new moons and your appointed feasts, my soul hateth. They are troubling to me. I am weary to bear them. And when you spread forth your hands and pray, I will hide my eyes from you. Yea, you'll make many prayers, and I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood. Wash you. Make you clean. Put away the evil of your doings from before my eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do well. Seek judgment. Relieve the oppressed. Judge the fatherless. Plead for the widow. God is fed up with our religious practices. God's fed up with seeing them week after week and their religious practices. Because their attitude was, as long as I do it the way God says to do it and I go through and get it done, I'm standing or in good standing with him. But here it said God had it up to his nose with it. Fed up with the way they were worshiping him. Why they gathered in the first place. Why they did what they did. God was sick of it. The multitude of your sacrifices, what are they to me that you just come and do them so you can say, I did that. I fulfilled my obligation. How'd you like to be married to somebody like that? They didn't care no more for you than, hey, I've done what I'm supposed to as a husband. I've done what I'm supposed to as a wife. Boy, that'd be a lot of fun, wouldn't it? Talk about belittling. And this is what they were doing to God. I've done what he's told me to do. Here it is, finished. I can check that off. That belittled him. God. God. And he was sick of it. I have no pleasure in the blood of bulls, lambs, and goats. When you come and you appear before me, who's asked you? In your attitude and the reason for you being here, who's asked you? In other words, the Lord don't want you in his worship service if you're not there for him. If you're come to make your little notes of who didn't show up today, and just how many new visitors do we have, and did so-and-so dye her hair again, Christine. Just kidding, Christine. If you're here to look and to check out everything so that you make your final report to yourself at the end of the day and able to text and to call and let everyone, then you're here for the wrong reason. The Lord would rather you stayed home. Do you understand that? If on your drive to work, you just can't wait to get there to get this off your mind or to find out this, or the Lord said, who asked you to come in the first place? With an attitude that says, keep your rear end at home. That's what the Lord says. Don't tread my courts. When he ain't here for his grace and mercy for you. Don't come here seeking grace and mercy for somebody else. Don't come here so that everybody else can be thankful you're here. You should be here. Desiring to worship him and be thankful to him for the grace and mercy you have received. But this isn't the attitude of the people in Isaiah's day. He says, stop bringing your offerings that mean nothing. Stop it. It's detestable to me. He says, I cannot bear your evil assemblies. Think of that just a second. Evil assemblies. That means it's very possible we could have one of those here at Sims Hill. An evil assembly. When you have come not to worship the Lord and be thankful to Him, but to help everybody else to be better like you. When you have not come to worship the Lord for His grace and mercy in your life, you've come to show everybody else how great you are and what a wonderful saint you are, so maybe they can receive God's grace and mercy. That was the attitude of them. Here, there's a checkoff list. We're so righteous, we're so good, we've done it yet again, another week, exactly the way the Lord told us to do it. And God said, I despise you. Strong words, ain't it? Strong words, ain't it? You spread out your hands to pray, and I'm not going to listen to you. Stop my ears, turn away. Hide my eyes from you, even when you make all kinds of prayers. You ever been in a church where 90% or 80% of what they do is praying? Every time you turn around, they're saying another prayer. They're praying for this and they're praying for that. That's all good and wonderful. But that reminds me of this right here. They're saying all kinds of prayers because they're so righteous. Don't get me wrong. We can have a service where we prayed continually. Met around the Lord's table on Sunday and pray. Sing a song, pray. But the point is here, if your heart's not right, you individually being here, all your praise and all that praying means absolutely nothing to Him at all. Nothing. Your hands are full of blood, He says. Wash and make yourselves clean. Stop doing wrong. Learn to do right. Learn judgment. Seek justice. Encourage people. Relieve the oppressed. Defend the cause of the fatherless. Plead the cause of the widow. So that you too can receive God's grace and mercy. Not that you've already attained it all and reached the plateau of Christianity, but you got a long way to go to be even bad. Because if that's our attitude, we realize the mercy and the grace that we need minute after minute, after day after day, after year after decade. We realize that, and we then come and worship Him as He desires to be worshiped. Realize something here. These are religious ordinances, right? Who told them to do these things? God did. That's exactly right. Why is He upset? They're doing what He told them to do. It's because of their lives daily that they lived and the attitude they came in His house with. And He was sickened of it. The problem wasn't the worship, service. The problem was the reason they were there to begin with. They came in wanting to get it done, get it through so they could get right back out and do what they'd always done, which was living in sin. But I better go and sacrifice. I better go and pray because that's what I'm supposed to do. And God was sick of it. Suppose we had a service that began with the preaching. Somewhere in there we had a song and then ended with a communion service. Could y'all handle that? No, because that ain't the way we're supposed to do it, right? Well, you have to find that Bible. I want you to get that Bible verse in there and let it tell me exactly how that's going. Because we get in a process, right? We get in a habit, all right? We're going to give announcements. We're going to sing a song. We're going to sing another song. We'll sing a communion hymn. Then maybe there's a special. Maybe not. Either way, then the preacher comes. Then we dismiss and go home, you know, as long as the communion service ends up somewhere in there. You change from anything at all, people's heads blow off. You know why that is? Because they're not here for the right reason to begin with. There's a process. There's a way. It goes A, B, C, and D. We shake hands. We go home. We've done our job. That's the attitudes of the people in Isaiah's day. And God said, because of that, I hate that. Am I saying we need to start having the communion service first, the communion service last, or the preaching first, whatever? I ain't said nothing. I'm saying it's our attitude about why we are here. If anything changes, we only sing one song. Oh, my gosh, we didn't sing but one song. Well, whoop-de-doo. If the preacher need to be, preacher need to preach. If there's a special singing, if we sing 10 songs, whoop-de-doo. Why are you here? That's the important question. And that's what God asked them, wasn't it? Who required you to be here? With the attitude in which you carry. I wonder how often our religion becomes just ritualism, empty acts. I'm religious, and this is why I do what I do. I do what I do because I'm religious. I do what I do because I'm perfect. I'm right there next to God Himself. So I have to do this and this and this. If you don't come to the worship services realizing your need for the mercy and the grace of God, you've walked in the doors for the wrong reason, and you should have stayed home. Because I'd rather God detest me outside His house than detest me in His house. That's just like if, you know, I could stand being at home and somebody saying something against me or not liking me all that much. It's that much worse when you're in their home face to face and you find out just how much they dislike you. And God disliked them, sodomites, as sodomites, as horrifically sinful people. When we lose our sight of why we come to worship, when we lose our sight of our purpose as Christian people in this world, that everything we do disgusts God. Everything we do is disappointing to the Lord. Repulsive in the eyes of God. Yeah, in Isaiah's day, all the people did all the right things, all the right ways. Right? And it repulsed God because they didn't do it for the right reason. Their purpose of being there was wrong. And God hated it. Imagine what it was like to show up in the temple in Isaiah's day as God. And be nauseated by what you saw, by what you heard. Oh, the temperature in the temple was right. Perfect. Nobody needed a blanket. Nobody needed to take off their suit coat. The temperature was perfect in the temple. Speaker music over the speakers, it wasn't too loud. It wasn't too quiet. No, all that was perfect. That ain't what God had a problem with, was it? He didn't have a problem with these things. They done all the right things for the wrong reasons. And God detested that. Their sacrifices, if you will, become an awful smell in the nostrils of God. He hated it because of why they were doing it. Oh, He had commanded it. He expected it. But He expected that out of a love and an honor and worship to Him. Not because they had to. Not because it was expected. Yet we read and we said that even in God's anger, He speaks words of hope. He speaks words of grace. He speaks it with tenderness. Look at verse 18 and 20. Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. If, big word, if ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat of the good of the land. But if you refuse, if you rebel, you shall be devoured with the sword. For the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it. It is amazing that in his anger, and he was angry here. The Lord was angry here. But even in his anger, he comes right along with some grace. He comes right along with mercy. Come now, now that I've told you what I know, maybe you didn't think I knew this, but I knew what was going on. Now come and let's reason together. And here's the reasoning. Here's the reasoning. You do what I tell you to do, the way I tell you, for the right reasons. Getting rid of sin in your life. Loving me as God. Boys, everything's going to be okay for you. You'll eat of the good of the land. But if you rebel. And by the way, they were worshiping, were they not? Yes. They were sacrificing, were they not? Yes. Had they rebelled? Yes. Because they didn't do it for the right purpose. They didn't do it out of love and a need for grace and mercy for themselves. They did it all wrong. And in that they had rebelled. He says, though your sins be like scarlet, I can make them white as snow. As long as you don't rebel. God wasn't going to overlook their sin. And reasoning with the people of Isaiah's day, he gave those two possibilities. And it's the same two possibilities we have today. What was written to the people in Isaiah's day, you better believe that applies to us today. Can our worship service make God sick? Yep, if it's just a ritual. If it's unbeating. I don't care if you come in here and you shake everybody's hand and you give every little kid a dollar bill. Don't care if you say 50 amens and roll your eyes back and pray over and over. Don't mean a thing if it ain't for the right reason and out of your heart as worship to God. It means nothing. So what was written to Isaiah is sure applicable to us today. It's sure meant for us today. You take the first of Isaiah, these chapters are filled with warning after warning after warning about sin and God's judgment. And then the last 20-some chapters of Isaiah are filled with God's promises to send a Savior, to send one to rescue, to send one to save, so that people can be brought back to God and his blessings. And that's all he wanted for the people in the day of Isaiah, is to be able to bless them. But do you not find it hard to bless somebody that just hates you with everything in them? Is it not hard to bless someone that pretty much by their life refuses to believe you exist? That's the way they did God. And that's the way we can do God today. If we do not come and worship him, as Jesus said, in spirit and in truth. Every worship service where we come in together needs to be for us to worship God. Needs to be for us to thank God, to obtain grace and mercy and thank him for it. And then everything we do is based on that. To bring God the glory. If it's not for that reason that you enter these courts, then it makes God awful upset. Because you're here for the wrong reasons, period. If God sat next to you in church today and observed your worship, knowing your mind, would he be pleased or offended with you today? He knows why you're here. He knows if your desire is to worship him and to thank him and to remember everything that he done through Jesus Christ. If he sat beside you today and observed how you worshiped and knew what you thought. If he rode to church with you in the car this morning, would he have gotten out thinking, man, here we're going into worship service? Or this person's half crazy. I don't know why they're going to church in the first place. What would God have said? Understand, it matters to God. Not just that we worship him, but how and why we worship him. That matters to God. Why we're here. We cannot get away with doing the right things in the right ways for the wrong purpose. We can't get away with that. We have to be here to worship God as God wants to be worshiped in truth and spirit, but with reverence and with desire and with love. So if that's the way it is, you need to change, he said. Repent. Do right for the right reasons. I can't imagine worshiping God with attitude just to get it over with. Not when I sit back and reflect everything God did for me yesterday, what he's done for me today, and you think of all the things in the past. He deserves worship. Because of Jesus Christ, he deserves to be honored and worshiped and honored by our worship. He deserves that. Do you believe that? Amen? Good, I wasn't sure. I'm glad to know it, though, that you think the proper worship is important. Because the people in Isaiah's day, they did not understand that. But you and I today need to understand that. Now, those separated from God, they can never please God. They can never have an acceptable worship because they're separated from God because of their sins. You can never do enough. You can't pray. You can't do anything separated from God and be able to please God. So we know that the one way in which he gives us to be brought back to God, to be saved, is through his grace and mercy of sending Jesus Christ to die for our sin. And if we will repent and be immersed, baptized, meeting that blood of Jesus that washes our sins away, we're brought back to the Lord to be as we was at the beginning in the Garden of Eden before the sin of Eve and Adam. He wants us back to there. And we get there through the blood of Jesus Christ when we are immersed. But to stay there, we have to worship him as he deserves to be worshiped. We have to care about the fatherless and the widows and those that need encouragement and those that need help. As long as you don't need no grace and mercy, you'll never be concerned enough to help another. And God saw this in their worship. Did you catch that? It's about repentance. It's not about being perfect because you don't care how much you've got it blowed up in your poor, thick skull that you're perfect. You are furthest from it. If you could be perfect, there would have been no reason for your own reason. Because of you, Jesus would never have to have come. But we're a lot farther from perfect than what we could ever realize. And until we repent and start being thankful to him for his grace and mercy and worshiping him in such a way, all we're going to do is live lives that are sickening to the Lord. And I don't want to do that. And I don't want you to do that. So we're going to sing a hymn of invitation. Now's the day and the time, Christians, for repentance and change. If you're outside the Lord, then now is the time to repent and come and be baptized, immersed, to have your sins washed away, that you can be brought back to God as holy, spotless, white, without a sin to your charge, then maybe you understand grace and mercy a little clearer then. But look around and see what the Lord's done for you, Christian. And know that He deserves honorable worship. I know we mentioned military people here, doesn't that? That's all great and wonderful. We've got churches that spend months getting ready for their honor, their people in military when such events and times of years rolls around. They never do that with God. They never do that with God. Yet they'll spend all kinds of time worshiping and lifting up men for something they've done or accomplished or been a part of. God don't want that in His house. This is about Him. Yes, we recognize, we thank, wonderful. This is God's house. This is God's time. And that's what the people in Isaiah's day, they just didn't realize. See, their worship service was about whom? There you go. Them. Their people, their family, their this, their that. And God said, you sickened me to my stomach. Because worship's supposed to be about Him. If you ain't got your heart right and you need change today, come. We're going to stand and sing verse 1.